earnestly say, in the name of Jesus Christ, what a parable. You know, we have a loving Lord that has provided so much for us, and that just thank you. Thank you so much. The if you think back to last week, the first 10 verses in Ephesians chapter 2, and Paul talks about the nature of mankind before salvation and how that nature is and what that nature is. Then he goes on to explain that God in his infinite love and mercy provided salvation through his son Jesus Christ. By grace you're saved through faith. And that brings us to today's text, because if you begin in verse 11, it begins with the word wherefore. Anytime you see the word wherefore in the scriptures, you need to look back at the previous verses and see why it is therefore. Okay, so, or if you see the words therefore. So that is, ties us back into where we're at today. So if you would follow with me as we go into reading the scriptures this morning. Wherefore, remember that you being in times past Gentiles in the flesh, who was called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope without God in this world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God and in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them which were nigh. For though through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore, you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto the holy temple in God, in the Lord, in whom you also are builded together for an habitation for God through the Spirit. May God bless the reading of his word. And I'm going to back us up here just a moment. To beginning with this here. This, I got sort of fascinated when, with this part of this chapter 2. It, matter of fact, I mentioned last week I had hoped to come in to finish up chapter 2 this week, and because of my fascination with these last verses here that we're going through. He begins talking about, you know, that the people, the Gentiles here in Ephesians, or at Ephesus, were in a situation to where they were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. I thought that was a kind of interesting. You know, we think of the word, you know, of aliens, and we think of it in situations such as, well, if you was from Roswell, you might think of a little green man with the no hair and big head, you know, that aliens that you saw there. Or, you know, if you're a little bit younger and like the movies, or not too young anymore because it's an old movie, E.T., remember, Phone Home, you might think of aliens that way. But then here we're thinking of aliens in a different way, someone that is a stranger. If you think of it in a political term today, we usually have another word that goes before alien in this country when we're thinking about a political, which is preposition. I was trying to think of that word. Preposition. We use the word legal and illegal as a preposition to alien in this country right now a lot. That they're, you know, that they're illegal aliens and they're legal here legally, some illegally. And we think of that right there. So you see how this is built up. But it starts talking about here in this that there was a division between the Jewish Christians and the non-Jewish, or the Jews and the non-Jewish people. Even all the way back to Abraham, and they begin talking about the circumcision being a part of that. In Genesis chapter 17, when Abraham, God speaking to Abraham, and I'm just going to read two verses out there, but I'm going for three verses, but I'm going to, the first one is chapter 17, verse 7, and he says, "And I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee in their generation for an everlasting covenant to be a God unto thee and thy seed after thee." So talking about that covenant that he's making, he goes all the way back to Abraham. Now, remember that all of the Jews said that their father was Abraham, and they were free. Remember how that when Jesus was talking to them about being in bondage, they said, "Well, hey, our father was Abraham, and we were free, you know, because of that." But here we see that covenant goes all the way back to Abraham. And then a couple of verses after that in chapter 17, and I'm skipping a little bit of those verses which are about that covenant, but let me read this right here. It goes on to explain, "This is my covenant which ye shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee. Every man child among you shall be circumcised, and you shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a token of the covenant betwixt me and you." And even we're talking about a child here, but then we're talking about also that if there was a stranger that come in and wanted to be a part of that, then one of the regulations, even for an adult, is that that man child would have to be circumcised to be a part of the Jewish family. So this is where Paul is talking to the Gentiles here, the Gentile Christians. He says, you know, that at, there was a time that you were not a part of the commonwealth or the community of faith of the Jewish people, that were a part of that community, and part of that, the circumcised were saying that you were uncircumcised and you were not part of it. Even Jesus at one point, remember the lady coming wanting healing for their child, and he says, you know, "It's not meant for me to give the food for the children to the dogs," you know, and so he's sort of acknowledged that separation that was going there, that was going on. But we see that there was, he talks about this, and he goes on in chapter 2, verse 11 and 12 there, he talks them that they had no hope and without God in the world. Could you imagine that for just a moment, that you were living without hope? You know, I think of those that take their life, and my understanding is they feel hopeless and helpless at the same time. That those two things come together. But the people he's saying here, that before Christ, before you become a Christian, before that, you were separated from the Jewish people. You weren't a part of that community of the Jewish people. And that you had no hope. There was no hope in that because the Jewish people were the children of promise. That's kind of hard to swallow. That. Especially when we see that down through the scriptures, and especially in the New Testament, where God sent his son to die for the world, for everyone. But here we see that separation between two. Now, remember that the Jews, during this time, the Jewish Christians even believed and considered themselves Jews, but they were Messianic Jews. They believed that Jesus Christ was the Messiah. You know, we use the word Messianic. We don't see that in the, as far as Messianic Jews, we don't see that in the scriptures, but we use that term today for Jewish people that have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord. But in this situation, even the Jewish Christians, those that have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, they felt like that they were Jews, and this was just an extension of their faith that they had raised in. So we see now that while the people was coming in, there was still a separation. There was almost the idea. I want to take us back, this might be a bad article. I might want to cut off the phones or videos for a moment here. But anyway, back when the church, early Church of the Brethren, if you come into the church, on this side of the church were women. On this side of the church was men. And never the twain meet in the church walls. You know, there was a separation there. And, you know, there's almost a separation of worth, and I don't want to say it that way. But there was a separation. But there was that separation between the Jewish Christian and the non and the Gentile Christian in this situation, where there was a divide. And he's bringing that into it. And that's where I love this text as we continue on, because he starts with another term again. You know, last week he said, but God, and I made a big point about but God and continued that all the way through the last, that point of the message, that it went just continually through there. But then we see here that now he says, but Christ. You know, but Christ, you know, but by the blood of Christ. And he says, let me read that first off of what we said last week about the but God. It says, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together in Christ. By grace you are saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. But now it's but Christ. Now let's sort of follow along here for just a moment here in the text here. And I'm going to read that 13 and through 15 again. It says, but now, in Christ Jesus, ye were sometimes were afar off, or made nigh by the blood of Christ. First, by the blood of Christ, we're no longer aliens. We're no longer separated. We are being made nigh because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. What was two different groups of people, now he has brought them together as one. But and he says that he goes on and talks about, says, having abolished in the flesh the enmity of the law, the commandments containing the oneness. And he says, he has made that peace with us. And he says, so making peace, he abolished these rules that was causing that separation. And he said, he has made peace between the Jews and the Gentiles. Wow. He brought people together that were separated and said, I want you two to be one. And matter of fact, he goes on and talks about it a little bit more and how that out of twain he made one people. You know, I think of another time that he made two into one. Bet y'all can remember it too. Because when a man leaves his father and mother and cleaves to his wife, and they too shall be made, become one. And he says, that's sort of the picture of this year. Now they have come together as two separate entities or groups and become one people. It says, but in Christ, through that blood, it says, the wall of separation between the Jews and the Gentiles were tore down. That's where that wall was showing there that I was thinking about. But there was another one that I can think back of. A tailor, I forget his first name, wrote a book and that was A Change of Allegiance. And he's got a picture of him. He was in the military, and he was stationed in Germany, and he was there during the time that the Berlin Wall was still erected. When he first saw that Berlin Wall, it was there. And a little later on, he went there, and they were tearing that wall down. That was when the fall of that wall was going on. And it's a picture of there of a hole in that wall about that far, and from the West Germany side, and somebody had stuck their hand through from East Germany and stuck through their hand to shake hands. You know, that wall that was separating those folk was being torn down. And God says, I have torn down that wall through the blood of Jesus Christ that's separating you. What a joyous, I mean, that is almost shouting time to me. Think about how that those walls have been broken down. For us, some my age, you can remember the places that you might go. I remember when when there was a particular supply house that I went to, that there was a place that there was drinking fountains that was set right here that says Whites. And then on the other side of the of some walls, there was the words Colored right beside of it. One black, one Negro. It was Colored. I remember that. And I can remember going to the supply house, and I remember the places that would not serve because there was a wall of separation between the black and the white in a lot of areas, and not all places that I remember, but in a lot of areas there was that separation. But God says He's tore down that wall of separation. Whether it be male, female, or whether it be black or white or Jewish, and non-Jewish people. He said, I've tore that down. That there is a common factor here. And it says, He's made twain out of one. Through what? Through the blood of Jesus Christ. That's how we become one people, is our common faith in Jesus Christ as Lord. The next few verses begin to talk about a reconciliation that happens. Reconciling both to God through the cross. Reconciling. He's reconciling them to each other, but He's also reconciling them now to God. That is the umbrella here. Beforehand, you had an umbrella that the Jewish people were under an umbrella of God's chosen people, and now we see that we're both children of Abraham under the umbrella because of the adoption through Jesus Christ and the precious blood that He has sent. We are made one. We have been reconciled by Jesus Christ and what He has done. Oh, wow. Something that we couldn't do, He is doing. Creating peace. It goes on and says, creating peace between God and mankind. Oh, wow. You know, He couldn't look at me. God the Father couldn't look upon sin. But because of what Jesus Christ has done on sin, it didn't cover my sin, it took away my sin. You know, the lamb that they would slay, or the bull or whatever, the pigeon that they would slay, would cover sin. But Jesus Christ's precious blood took away the sin of mankind. Wow. And by faith we accept that. I think of the saying that was on a marquee that we had put up at a church one time. It said, no peace, or no God, no peace. And that was N-O God, N-O peace. And then underneath of it, it had K-N-O-W, no God, and then K-N-O-W, peace. No God, if you don't have God, there can't be peace. But God brought peace. If you know Him, if you put your trust in Him and accepted Him, there is peace available to you, and you can know peace that goes through that. He preached peace to both, it says in those texts. He preached peace to them that they might have that peace between each other and between themselves, between them and God. Jew and Gentile now having access to the Father by the same Spirit, it says. By that self-same Spirit, we have access to God the Father, whether you are Jew or whether you're Gentile. Whether you're man, woman, whether you're whatever you are in the human race, you have access to God through that same Spirit. That is good news. That is great news. You don't have to be wealthy. You don't have to be educated. You don't have to be anything. You just got to put your faith in Jesus Christ, repent of those sins, and come to Christ as your Savior. And then it goes on for the last few verses. They're talking just a little bit more about something. It says, now in Christ Jesus, we are. You know, that's what I put at the top of this little, my outline here. We are no longer strangers. Strangers no more in the covenant of promise. Wow. We're not strangers anymore because of Jesus Christ. Now in Christ Jesus, because you are in Him and He is in you and through the Holy Spirit, we are no longer strangers to that covenant of promise. But we have that. And we are fellow citizens with the saints. We are fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Good news. Powerful news. Obviously, a news that should be If we were in a Baptist church, they'd be shouting right now. If we was in a Pentecostal, they might even swing from the chandelier. But, you know, that is good news that we have. And then, but in Christ Jesus, now we are fitted together, grown into a holy temple in the Lord. Wow. That we are fitted together. You know, I think about, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit as individuals, because the Holy Spirit comes and lives within us. No, you're not, that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. But then I think about how that God, you know, uses each one of us as building blocks. And it says that we're fitted together with that, and along with the apostles and the prophets, and then, wow, the chief cornerstone being Jesus Christ himself. A part of that holy temple being built together for a dwelling place of God. Yeah, for his dwelling. Yeah, he dwells within our gatherings, because we come together where two or three are gathered together. There he is in the midst of them. We are the dwelling place, the temple of our God, as we gather together. Whether it is at a communion service where we talk about communion and being one with each other and one with God, or whether it's in a worship service such as our Sunday morning service, or whether it's in a time of spontaneous gathering that we have together, and God is in the center of it. We are being built together. Being. I like that word being, because I think about where I was, even though I'm not who I used to be. I'm not who I'm going to be either, because God is still working on me. God has got his fingerprints trying to move me into a place that he ought to be. And each one of us Christians can say that very same thing, because God is not finished with us. If he was finished with us, we would be in a grave and our spirit would be in heaven with him. He says, I don't need you here on earth anymore. I'll take you home. He's not finished with him yet. He's still working. He's got work for you to do, and he's still working for you. Praise God. Praise God. We are not what we are. And God is not finished with us. He is still working on you and me. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you and adore you. We thank you that there is no difference. Lord, we think of how that how it used to be before Christ, and how that you had people like Samaritans that were just dogs, and you had people that were, people had opinions of that way, Lord, let's put it that way, not necessarily you, because you love them. But Lord, you've done away with that, and you showed us that through Jesus Christ, that you've made a way for us to come together as one body of people, the unity that you called for, the unity, Lord Jesus, that you prayed for in the Gospel of John, of how that we would be one as Jesus is one with you, Father. That prayer of such an importance that he, in his latter time here on this earth with his disciples, he prayed that prayer. And Lord, help us. We're still working on that. We're struggling with that. Lord, we got different denominations. We got different groups. And sometimes within the same denomination, we can't do nothing but squabble. Help us, Lord. Help us to be one as you have called us to be one. And Lord, most of all, help us to be one with you. And Lord, that comes through our personal relationship with you, because then and only then can we know peace. Of course, in the name of Jesus, we ask.